हरे कृष्णा, प्लीज एक्सेप्ट माय हम्बल ओबेसेंसेस ऑल गुरु श्रील प्रभुपाद. विल बिगिन टुडे विद द प्रेयर्स. ओम अज्ञान तिमिरांधस्य ज्ञानांजना शलाखया चक्षुरुन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः. श्री चैतन्य मनोभीष्टं स्थापितं येन भूतले स्वयं रूप कदा मह्यं ददाति स्वपदान्तिकम्. वन्देहं श्रीगुरु श्रीयुतपदकमलं श्रीगुरुन् वैष्णवांश्च श्रीरूपं साग्रजातं सहगणरघुनाथान्वितं तं सजीवं साद्वैतं सावधूतं परिजनसहितं कृष्णचैतन्यदेवम् श्रीराधा कृष्णपादान् सहगणललिता श्रीविशाखान्वितांश्च. हे कृष्णा करुणा सिंधो दीनबंधो जगत्पते गोपेश गोपिकाकांत राधाकांत नमोस्तुते. तप्त कांचन गौरांगी राधे वृंदावनेश्वरी वृषभानुसुते देवी प्रणमामि हरिप्रिये. वाञ्छाकल्पतरुभ्यश्च कृपा सिन्धुभ्य एव च पतितानां पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः. जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासादि गौरभक्तवृंद. हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे हरे. हरे रामा राम राम हरे हरे. सो लास्ट वीक वी डिस्कस्ड अबाउट द स्ट्रक्चर ऑफ द बनियन ट्री. सो कृष्णा डिस्क्राइब्स द एनालॉजी ऑफ द बनियन ट्री इन द बिगिनिंग ऑफ द 15th चैप्टर to indicate that actually this material world is nothing but a perverted reflection of the spiritual world. And the material world is exactly like the spiritual world, but it is like a banyan tree which is on the bank of a river, and we can see its reflection in the water. And the roots are upward and the branches are downward. So basically it's a reflection. So if there is a tree on the bank of a river and we see its reflection, then what happens is whatever is closest to the reflecting surface, we see it first. So we see the trunk of the tree closest to the top, and then we see the branches further away in the reflection. So that is actually the structure of the material universe also. The reason why it is inverted is because of the desires of the living entities. And the desire is the reflecting surface. So the only difference between the spiritual world or spiritual consciousness and material world and material consciousness is the desire of the living entity. So if the living entity desires to serve the Supreme Lord, to understand that he is actually a servant of the Supreme Lord, if that understanding and consciousness is clear, then it is spiritual consciousness. And the reflection of it in the material world is we want to satisfy our desires and our plans. So that is the only difference. So by changing our desires, we can move very easily from material consciousness to spiritual consciousness. And actually, if we cannot make that distinction, if that understanding is not clear, then what Krishna also describes what happens to a person if that understanding is not clear, is that they will remain entangled in the branches of the material banyan tree. So depending on what desire they have, they will keep moving from one desire to another desire. That means basically they will be trying to satisfy their senses which when someone tries to satisfy their senses, such actions are called as fruitive desires or fruitive actions, and they can never make it to the other side, to the kingdom of God. So we also took the time to draw the banyan tree. And the understanding was that through determination, one can actually cut down the tree with the weapon of detachment. And one can actually do it by surrendering to the Supreme Lord with the help from the Supreme Lord. We can, even though we have lived on this banyan tree for time immemorial, still it is possible to move past that to the spiritual consciousness, to the kingdom of God. So actually both the consciousness as well as the physical place, the spiritual world, it's possible to move. So we will begin from text 5, and let's aim for completing until 10. And if we can actually read beyond that, that's also fine. So would anybody like to read text 5?
Read, Mataji.
Sure, Mataji. Thank you.
You're welcome. Text 5. Nirmana moha jita sangha dosha adhyatma nitya vinivrata kama dvandvair vimukta sukha dukha samajner gachanti amuda padam avyayam tat. Those who are free from false prestige, illusion, and false association, who understand the eternal, who are done with material lust, who are freed from the dualities of happiness and distress, and who, unbewildered, know how to surrender unto the Supreme Person, attain to that eternal kingdom. Purport. The surrendering process is described here very nicely. The first qualification is that one should not be deluded by pride, because the conditioned soul is puffed up, thinking himself the lord of material nature. It is very difficult for him to surrender unto the Supreme Personality of Godhead. One should know by the cultivation of real knowledge that he is not lord of material nature. The Supreme Personality of Godhead is the Lord. When one is free from delusion caused by pride, he can begin the process of surrender. For one who is always expecting some honor in this material world, it is not possible to surrender to the Supreme Person. Pride is due to illusion, for although one comes here, stays for a brief time, and then goes away, he has the foolish notion that he is the Lord of the world. He thus makes all things complicated, and he is always in trouble. The whole world moves under this impression. People are considering the land, this earth, to belong to human society, and they have divided the land under the false impression that they are the proprietors. One has to get out of this false notion that human society is the proprietor of this world. When one is freed from such a false notion, he becomes free from all the false associations caused by familial, social, and national affections. These faulty associations bind one to this material world. After this stage, one has to develop spiritual knowledge. One has to cultivate knowledge of what is actually his own and what is actually not his own. And when one has an understanding of things as they are, he becomes free from all dual conceptions such as happiness, distress, pleasure, and pain. He becomes full in knowledge, then it is possible for him to surrender to the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Text 6. Natad bhashayate suryo na shashanko na pavaka yad gatva na nirvantate tad dhamma Paramam Mama. That supreme abode of mine is not illuminated by the sun or moon, nor by fire or electricity. Those who reach it never return to this material world. The spiritual world, the abode of the Supreme Personality of Godhead Krishna, which is known as Krishna Lok, Goloka Vrindavan, is described here. In the spiritual sky, there is no need of sunshine, moonshine, fire, or electricity because all the planets are self-luminous. We have only one planet in this universe, the sun, which is self-luminous, but all the planets in the spiritual sky are self-luminous. The shining effulgence of all those planets called Vaikunthas constitutes the shining sky known as Brahmajyoti. Actually, the effulgence is emanating from the planet of Krishna, Goloka Vrindavan. Part of that shining effulgence is covered by Mahatattva, the material world. Other than this, the major portion of that shining sky is full of spiritual planets, which are called Vaikunthas, chief of which is Goloka Vrindavan. As long as a living entity is in this dark material world, he is in conditional life, but as soon as he reaches the spiritual sky by cutting through the false perverted tree of this material world, he becomes liberated. Then there is no chance of his coming back here. In his conditional life, the living entity considers himself to be the lord of this material world, but in his liberated state, he enters into the spiritual kingdom and becomes an associate of the Supreme Lord. There he enjoys eternal bliss, eternal life, and full knowledge. One should be captivated by this information. He should desire to transfer himself to that eternal world and extricate himself from this false reflection of reality. For one who is too much attached to this material world, it is very difficult to cut that attachment. But if he takes to Krishna consciousness, there is a chance of gradually becoming detached. One has to associate himself with devotees, those who are in Krishna consciousness. One should search out a society dedicated to Krishna consciousness and learn how to discharge devotional service. In this way, he can cut off his attachment to the material world. One cannot become detached from the attraction of the material world simply by dressing himself in saffron cloth. He must become attached to the devotional service of the Lord. Therefore, one should take it very seriously that devotional service, as described in the 12th chapter, is the only way to get out of this false representation of the real tree. In chapter 14, the contamination of all kinds of processes by material nature is described. Only devotional service is described as purely transcendental. The word paramam mama are very important here. Actually, every nook and corner is the property of the Supreme Lord, but the spiritual world is paramam, full of six opulences. The Katha Upanishad 2.2.15 also confirms that in the spiritual world, there is no need of sunshine, moonshine, or stars. Na tatra suryopati, na chandra tarakam. For the whole spiritual sky is illuminated by the internal potency of the Supreme Lord. That supreme abode can be achieved only by surrender and by no other means. Text 7. Mama vamso jiva loke jiva bhuta sanatanah mana shashta nindriyani prakriti sthani karsati. The living entities in this conditioned world are my eternal fragmental parts. Due to conditioned life, they are struggling very hard with the six senses, which include the mind. Purport. In this verse, the identity of the living being is clearly given. The living entity is the fragmental part and parcel of the Supreme Lord eternally. It is not that he assumes individuality in his conditional life and in his liberated state becomes one with the Supreme Lord. He is eternally fragmented. It is clearly said, Sanatana. According to the Vedic version, the Supreme Lord manifests and expands himself in innumerable expansions, of which the primary expansions are called Vishnu Tattva and the secondary expansions are called the living entities. In other words, the Vishnu Tattva is the personal expansion and the living entities are the separated expansions. By his personal expansion, he is manifested in various forms like Lord Rama, Narasimha Dev, Vishnumurti, and all the predominating deities in the Vaikuntha plants. The separated expansions of the living entities are eternally servitors. The personal expansions of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, the individual identities of the Godhead are always present. Similarly, the separated expansions of the living entities have their identities. As fragmental parts and parcels of the Supreme Lord, the living entities also have fragmental portions of his qualities, of which independence is one. Every living entity as an individual soul has his personal individuality and a minute form of independence. By misuse of that independence, one becomes a conditioned soul, and by proper use of independence, he is always liberated. In either case, he is qualitatively eternal, as the Supreme Lord is. In his liberated state, he is freed from this material condition, and he is under the engagement of transcendental service unto the Lord. In his conditioned life, he is dominated by the material modes of nature and he forgets the transcendental loving service of the Lord. As a result, he has to struggle very hard to maintain his existence in the material world. The living entities, not only human beings and the cats and dogs, but even the greater controllers of the material world, Brahma, Lord Shiva, and even Vishnu are all parts and parcels of the Supreme Lord. They are all eternal, not temporary manifestations. The word karsati, struggling or grappling hard, is very significant. The conditioned soul is bound up as though shackled by iron chains. He is bound up by the false ego, and the mind is the chief agent which is driving him in this material existence. When the mind is in the mode of goodness, his activities are good. When the mind is in the mode of passion, his activities are troublesome. And when the mind is in the mode of ignorance, he travels in the lower species of life. It is clear, however, in this verse that the conditioned soul is covered by the material body with the mind and the senses, and when he is liberated, his material covering perishes, but his spiritual body manifests itself in its individual capacity. The following information is there in the Madhyandinayana Shruti, Save Isha Brahma Nishta Idam Shariram Mrityam Atis Rijya Brahma Visampadya Brahmana Pashyati Brahmana Shrunoti Brahmane Vedam Sarvam Anubhavati. It is stated here that when a living entity gives up this material embodiment and enters into the spiritual world, he revives his spiritual body, and in his spiritual body, he can see the Supreme Personality of Godhead face to face. He can hear and speak to him face to face, and he can understand the Supreme Personality as he is. From Smriti, also it is understood, Vasanti Yat Yatra Purusha Sarva Vaikunte Murtyah. In the spiritual planets, everyone lives in bodies featured like the Supreme Personality of Godheads. As far as bodily construction is concerned, there is no difference between the part and parcel living entities and the expansions of Vishnumurti. In other words, at liberation, the living entity gets a spiritual body by the grace of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. The words Mama Eva Vamsa, the fragmental parts and parcels of the Supreme Lord, are also very significant. The fragmental portion of the Supreme Lord is not like some material broken part. We have already understood in the second chapter that the spirit cannot be cut into pieces. This fragment is not materially conceived. It is not like matter, which can be cut into pieces and joined together again. That conception is not applicable here because the Sanskrit word sanatan, eternal, is used. The fragmental portion is eternal. It is also stated in the beginning of the second chapter that in each and every individual body, the fragmental portion of the Supreme Lord is present. Dehino smin yatha dehi. That fragmental portion, when liberated from the bodily entanglement, revives its original spiritual body in the spiritual sky, in a spiritual planet, and enjoys association with the Supreme Lord. It is, however, understood here that the living entity, being the fragmental part and parcel of the Supreme Lord, is qualitatively one with the Lord, just as the parts and parcels of the gold are also gold.
Hare Krishna. Thank you, Mataji, for reading. So we will give a chance for someone else to read. Would anybody else like to read?
Hare Krishna, Mataji, Sudevi Sakhi.
Yes, Mataji.
Can I read?
Yes, Mataji.
Verse number 8. Shariram yat avapnoti yachapyutkaramaktishvarah grihit vaitani samyati vayurgandhan ivashayat. Translation: the living entity in the material world carries his different conceptions of life from one body to another as the air carries aromas. Thus he takes one kind of body and again quits it to take another. Offered by His Divine Grace Srila Prabhupada Ki Jai. Here the living entity is described as Ishvara, the controller of his own body. If he likes, he can change his body to a higher grade. And if he likes, he can move to a lower class. Minute independence is there. The change his body undergoes depends upon him. At the time of death, the consciousness he has created will carry him on to the next type of body. If he has made his consciousness like that of a cat or a dog, he is sure to change to a cat's or a dog's body. And if he has fixed his consciousness on godly qualities, he will change into the form of a demigod. And if he is in Krishna consciousness, he will be transferred to Krishna Loka in the spiritual world and will associate with Krishna. It is a false claim that after the annihilation of this body, everything is finished. The individual soul is transmigrating from one body to another, and his present body and present activities are the background of his next body. One gets a different body according to karma, and he has to quit this body in due course. It is stated here that the subtle body, which carries the conception of the next body, develops another body in the next life. This process of transmigrating from one body to another and struggling while in the body is called karshati, or struggle for existence. Verse number 9. Shrotram chakshu sparshanam cha rasanam grinan rasanam ghranam eva cha adhishtaya manaschayam vishayan upasevate. Translation: the living entity, thus taking another gross body, obtains a certain type of ear, eye, tongue, nose, and sense of touch, which are grouped about the mind. He thus enjoys a particular sense of sense objects. Purport: in other words, if the living entity adulterates his consciousness with the qualities of cats and dogs, in his next life he gets a cat or dog body and enjoys. Consciousness is originally pure like water, but If we mix water with a certain color, it changes. Similarly, consciousness is pure, for the spirit soul is pure. But consciousness is changed according to the association of the material qualities. Real consciousness is Krishna consciousness. When therefore one is situated in Krishna consciousness, he is in his pure life. But if his consciousness is adulterated by some type of material mentality, in the next life he gets a corresponding body. He does not necessarily get a human body again. He can get the body of a cat, dog, hog, demigod, or one of many other forms, for there are 8,400,000 species. Verse number 10. Utkramantam sthitam vapi bhunjanam va gunanvitam vimudhananu pashyanti jnana chakshushah. Translation: the foolish cannot understand how a living entity can quit his body, nor can they understand what sort of body he enjoys under the spells of the modes of nature. But one whose eyes are trained in knowledge can see all this. But the word jnana chakshushah is very significant. Without knowledge, one cannot understand how a living entity leaves his present body, nor what form of body he is going to take in the next life, nor even why he is living in a particular type of body. This requires a great amount of knowledge understood from Bhagavad Gita and similar literatures heard from a bona fide spiritual master. One who is trained to perceive all these things is fortunate. Every living entity is quitting his body under certain circumstances. He is living under certain circumstances and he is enjoying under certain circumstances under the spell of material nature. As a result, he is suffering different kinds of happiness and distress under the illusion of sense enjoyment. Persons who are everlastingly fooled by lust and desire lose all power to understand their change of body and their stay in a particular body. They cannot comprehend it. Those who have developed spiritual knowledge, however, can see that the spirit is different from the body and is changing its body and enjoying in different ways. A person in such knowledge can understand how the conditioned living entity is suffering in the material existence. Therefore, those who are highly developed in Krishna consciousness try their best to give this knowledge to the people in general, for their conditioned life is very much troublesome. They should come out of it and be Krishna conscious and liberate themselves to transfer to the spiritual world. Hare Krishna.
Thank you, Mataji. Would someone else like to read text 11? Because text 11 is also connected to the sets of verses we are discussing.
Hare Krishna, Mataji.
Hare Krishna.
Text 11. यतन्तो योगिनश्चैनां पश्यन्ति आत्मनि अवस्थितं यतन्तोपय अकृतात्मनो नैनं पश्यन्ति अशेषसा. Translation: the endeavoring transcendentalists who are situated in self-realization can see all this clearly, but those whose minds are not developed and who are not situated in self-realization cannot see what is taking place, though they may try. Purport: there are many transcendentalists on the path of self-realization, but one who is not situated in self-realization cannot see how things are changing in the body of the living entity. The word yogina is significant in this connection. In the present day, there are so many so-called yogis, and there are so many so-called association of yogis, but they are actually blind in the matter of self-realization. They are simply addicted to some sort of gymnastic exercise and are satisfied if the body is well-built and healthy. They have no other information. They are called Yatanto pai akrita atmanaha. Even though they are endeavoring in a so-called yoga system, they are not self-realized. Such people cannot understand the process of transmigration of the soul. Only those who are actually in the yoga system and have realized the self, the world, and the Supreme Lord In other words, the bhakti yogis, those engaged in pure devotional service in Krishna consciousness, can understand how things are taking place.
Thank you, Mataji. So this is basically continuation from where we left off. There is a description of the tree, but Krishna is elaborating further in these verses from 5 through 11. Would anybody like to share the main points or what inspired them from these verses? Or any practical applications?
Mataji, can I share, Mataji?
Yes, Mataji.
So, Mataji, today we started reading from 15.5. So, before that, as you summarized, that we understood from the first four verses that this tree, which is perverted reflection of the spiritual tree, is actually, we have to cut the roots of this tree by detachment. And for that, we have to surrender to Krishna. And here, the surrendering process is being explained in 15.5. First qualification is to not be deluded by pride. And pride is due to the illusion that we are this body. And we have that false ego because of which we have we want to enjoy. And that's the reason we are unaware of the real truth, that we are actually spirit souls and part and parcels of Krishna and actually eternally servitors of Krishna. And because of that, we are trapped in this material world. And in 15.6...
Can I briefly interrupt?
Yeah.
This is a question for everybody. So what is pride? What, in your opinion, is pride?
Mataji, the pride here they are mentioning is a false prestige, which is the false ego, basically.
Okay. Anybody else would like to try?
I am the superior attitude. I am the controller and I am controlling everyone. That attitude is pride.
Mm-hmm. Would anybody else like to share? What is pride?
So one, like, to expecting some honor, and like sometimes we get puffed up with someone is praised to us or something.
Yes, these are all manifestations of pride. Would anybody else like to try? What is pride?
We just think, Mataji, that everything, like, we are the owners of the land, like we feel that everything belongs to us. We kind of tend to take proprietorship of everything around us.
Yes, Mataji. Ramcharan Prabhu, you were trying to say something?
I was trying to say the same thing as Mataji is saying, like I'm the doer mentality. So that is kind of pride, and not recognizing our constitutional position.
The purport, Mataji, specific lines mentioned related to pride is like that we have a foolish notion that we are the lord of the world, and another is one has to get out of this false notion that human society is the proprietor of this world. When one is freed from such a false notion, he becomes free from all the false association caused by familial, social, and national affections. And these faulty associations bind one to the material world.
Yeah, thank you for sharing. So, like, if you have to describe it to somebody, like, you know, what pride is and what is the root cause of pride, how would you describe it to someone? Like, everything that all of you have said is valid, correct, but what is at the root of pride? Like, how would you describe it to somebody?
I
Mataji, actually, the six anarthas, which is mentioned, which are actually obstacles in the path of devotional service, the six enemies of the mind, which is lust, anger, greed, pride, illusion, attachment. So in that context, I think Bhagavad Gita, earlier it has been mentioned that like from lust, initially the person wants to satisfy his desires. So lust, from lust, if that desire is fulfilled, then he becomes more greedy to get more desires fulfilled. If it is not fulfilled, then it causes frustration, because of which wrath or anger comes. And then further, when you achieve something, or when you think that you are materially very affluent, or whether it be in wealth or education or anything, you feel proud without thinking that whatever is happening, whether you actually slog for it, do a lot of hard work or not, it is your karma which is bringing you the good things which are coming or the bad things which are coming. All your karma from all the previous births, everything is the result of which is now you are living a good life or a bad life. So, but one doesn't realize that. He thinks that whatever I did, whatever hard work I put, that is what is the reason of my success or something. And he's in an illusion that and everything is basis his karma, or is basis his effort. And because he thinks that after this life there is nothing else, and whatever I have to do, I have to enjoy to the fullest. And even some people are in the process of saving a lot of money for the future generations also. Okay, so. Okay.
Yeah, I mean, like, you know, it can manifest in so many different ways. It's true.
There's one very famous statement, I think. I don't know where it's from, but I've heard it many times. It says, pride goeth before the fall.
Mm-hmm.
And I think pride is something that keeps us sort of above water. Like, it keeps us in a quote-unquote elevated position, although it may be a false position. Mm-hmm. As long as we're prideful, we don't fall down, sort of thing. But, however, there should be some way to dovetail the propensity for pride into confidence, so that... remain confident, and also we don't fall down. Like, sometimes if we're sitting at a table and we're serving prasadam and we're thinking, oh, I hope I don't drop the prasadam, I hope it reaches the plate okay, and then suddenly we drop a piece of the morsel of the prasadam and the most of the prasadam gets to the person's plate. Mm-hmm. So our motor reflexes, our motor activities are so tied into our thinking, because the body is a very dynamic machine. Somehow, through the shastra, through the chanting, there should be a way to dovetail pride into confidence, which is different. So pride could be offensive. Confidence will be uplifting to yourself and to everyone around us.
Mm-hmm.
So that's just a little bit of point. Thank you. Yeah. Hare Krishna.
Thank you for sharing, Dushyant Prabhu. And thank you, everyone, for sharing. Actually, it is like everything that all of you have shared is like, valid to describe pride. And I had heard a very interesting definition of pride. They said pride is when we touch, when we lose touch with reality. And humility is actually reality. So, as all of you have also described, and I'm just adding to what all of you have said, when we do not understand the whole picture of what is going on, when we do not understand who Krishna is, when we do not fully understand who we are or the material world around us, is that lack of understanding or the lack of understanding of reality manifests as pride. And it can manifest in so many different ways. And the opposite of pride is humility. Humility means having a clear understanding of what is around us. So we may not understand every detail, but we understand the overall principle that we are servants of God and everything is in Krishna's control. So I just wanted to share that also, because the first time I heard it, like, it made a lot of sense. So would anybody like to continue, like, with what else was interesting for them through our discussion?
Mataji, can I tell more about 15.6 and 7 also?
Mataji, let's give someone else a chance and then you can come back if no one else wants to speak.
Mataji, I have a question regarding the pride. Is it okay? I can ask now or later on?
Yes, you can ask, Mataji.
Yeah, so in our day-to-day life, how do we, you know, practically apply this? Because there is always a tendency, even though being devotees, so there is like, there is sometimes there is appreciation or there is, okay, sometimes we get that doer and mentality, like especially me, I get sometimes, so it is very difficult for me to, you know, cope up with the pride and, you know, come back to my again back to square one. So how do I deal with this pride and, you know, to improve myself? And
yes, nice question, Mataji. Would anybody like to try, like, what is helping them on a practical level? Would anybody like to share something?
Mataji, I heard from in a recent class which I attended that
Mataji, can you speak something from your practical experience also? How do you feel about it personally?
Yes, Mataji. Personally, I feel I also suffer from this anartha and I have to work on it. And the reason for that is, although we know that we are spirit souls and all the theory which we read, we have read, but we have not realized it. That is the main problem. We are still in that process and we are learning. The theory has to turn into practicality. Whatever we are reading, we have to implement it in at least part by part into our life. And that is what is my effort all the time, that whatever we learn, even a little bit, whatever we hear, if something we can implement, that would be a good change. And we have to sustain that change. Another thing is the pride is very common. I did something good, I feel okay, I have done a very nice job. Especially devotees also appreciate each other. So sometimes people get puffed up. And sometimes you see senior devotees, they will always transfer the praise to Srila Prabhupada or to Guru Maharaj or to other devotees, or they will. So always it is said that whenever there is somebody praises, you just transfer the praise to your Guru Maharaj or Prabhupada or devotees, like that. So that way you will stay humble. That is one thing. Second, I'm still working, so Mataji, from my personal experience, I wouldn't say anything, but what I heard, I wanted to share because I felt if we keep that point in mind, we will try at least to not get puffed up. So what I heard is, if anybody thinks that I am better than some other person, such person cannot even reach heavenly planets. What about Vaikunthas, or what about the spiritual world? So you can't even go to the higher planetary systems if somebody thinks in that way. So if you think that you are better than somebody, that is a pride. So that means you are not even eligible to go to heavenly planets, then what, you will enter the spiritual world? So since as devotees, we are always aiming to go back to Goloka or spiritual planets, we should always remember that this pride will be the most important thing. It will be a big obstacle for us to go back to Godhead. So if we keep reminding ourselves this point, slowly we will come to a position where we understand that we have to be more humble. That is what I can share, Mataji.
Thank you, Mataji.
Thank you.
Thank you for sharing. Mataji, I also want to add something. From my personal experience, I feel as if, you know, this process of Krishna consciousness and the process of the material world is self-correcting. So if we actually become too proud, like, you know, Krishna will show it to us. He will, of course, like, you know, whatever Sudevi Mataji was saying is true, because it is only because of someone else we are where we are today. You know, our parents had to raise us for so many years. We were helpless as a child, but they took care of us when we didn't even know, like, anything else other than crying when we felt hungry. So from such a helpless state, like, someone, like, took care of us at every stage of our life. Someone taught us how to read and write. Someone took care of us in school. Then someone gave us a book, or, you know, invited us to come to Krishna consciousness. So at every stage of our life, we are dependent on someone else, on the mercy of someone else. So that is a reality. But then, like, you know, if we fall out of place, like, life always shows us. Krishna always shows us, and that is also his mercy. You know, Krishna can show us in so many different ways. He can put an obstacle in front of us, and, like, you know, like, it can be just an emotional obstacle. It doesn't have to be a very difficult situation, but just an emotional obstacle, and, like, you know, and then, you know, we become more thoughtful when there are obstacles. So Krishna can do anything, actually, here. But this process is self-correcting. Like, if we hear and chant, we will recognize what the reality is.
And that helps, Mataji. Thank you so much.
Anybody else who would like to say something?
Yeah, this is something I hear always from my spiritual master. Like, he says, in three steps process, first, recognize. So we know that we are conditional people, conditional souls. So that's why we are here. So kind of recognizing the weakness. So that does not mean it is a building of negativity, but it's actually bringing us to the, from the mode of passion to the mode of goodness, or mode of ignorance to the mode of goodness. Basically, it is kind of settling down the state of mind, recognizing that I am him. And then he advises that accept. So accept does not mean, like, again, it is coming to the reality. So, and then when I accept this thing, and then the next thing is move forward. So the move forward is, okay, I have this, I'm accepting this. So what is the next doable steps I can do?
Mm-hmm.
The practically, not really just comparing with someone who are very advanced. It is kind of practically not feasible just to take that the big step. So like a baby step, step by step, he says, just to have a higher consciousness and take a shelter of the way where you can take the guidance.
Mm-hmm.
That may be Guru, Sadhu, Shastra, and then just lay down the plan, and then the step by step. So like practically when we like, you know, without any philosophy, these are something anyone can understand, anyone can do, even in the not only spiritual life, even the in any practical life, these are mm-hmm. the three things I think will help us.
Yes, Prabhu.
Mataji, Ramcharan Prabhu, could you just repeat those steps? What you said, one is to recognize, second is to accept, and then?
The move forward.
Okay, so how do we like get rid of the pride thing?
How we get rid of the pride thing? So these are the plans. Like first you know that you recognize that you have a pride. Okay, then the accept that I have this thing, and then the have a plan. What is what are practical plans? Take the just approach spiritual master or Shiksha Guru or Sadhu Shastra, just to discuss with him, and then, you know, these are the things. So they may give some plan, practical plan, whatever it may be, very small things, small things, just we can start. And then they just again feedback, and then we can correct it, and then this process goes on. As Mataji was telling, it's anyway correction process, so it's a process. Bhakti itself is a, was hearing today, bhakti itself is a correction process. It has a tendency to remove all these impurities or anarthas.
Mataji, any practical tips how to overcome this anartha?
Yeah, thank you, Ramcharan Prabhu. It was very nice to hear from you. And I think whatever Prabhu has said is very nice. Like one other thing that comes to my mind is Maharaj gave the example of his god brother. He took every day he thought that the way he could overcome his pride was to serve the devotees of the Lord without expecting any recognition from them. So he had a small sheet of paper which he carried around every day. And what he did was he put 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and he did 5 things for 5 different devotees, but he would do it without the devotee noticing him doing that service for him. So anything, like, you know, we can pick anything like that, like, you know, but it has to be something that we do it regularly every day and consistently. Then we can see some transformation or some realization. Krishna will become pleased by our effort, and he will give some further inspiration to move forward.
Thank you, Mataji.
Is there anybody else who would like to share from 6, text 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 and 11, anything that was appealing to them, that felt was new or important from what we read.
Hare Krishna, Mataji.
Hare Krishna.
I would like to share about text 7, about our free will choice, like our independence. So there are either you like misuse of this independence, one becomes a conditioned soul, and by proper use of independence, he is always liberated. So there are two choices in our hands. Either we surrender to Maya or we surrender to Krishna. And if we surrender to Maya, but we know that Maya is not going to deliver whatever it promises. So why to surrender to Maya, but rather surrender to Krishna? So that's what I really triggered in my mind.
Yeah, thank you for sharing that. Actually, this is a very, very important point. Because actually, in this human form of life, as a living entity, we often forget that we have this choice. Every person, actually, they think that, you know, they have to do whatever is the dictation of the mind and the senses. It's not true. We can always choose. You know, late at night, like, you know, we may feel like eating samosas or pizza. We may feel like eating, but it's not necessary that we have to act on it. So that's where is the distinction between the mind and senses and the intelligence. So the mind and senses may say, like, you know, oh, eat the pizza. Like, you know. And the intelligence can come in and say, okay, if you eat the pizza, like, you know, you may not be able to digest it because it's so late at night. So similarly, like, you know, in any activity that we do, any choice, we have many choices. And we are choosing very knowingly or unknowingly, we are making a decision. But if we can actually train ourselves to choose Krishna, that will be the perfection of our life. And Prabhupada is teaching us through all of his purports how to make that choice. Sometimes it may be difficult, sometimes it may be easy, but the choice always lies with us. So thank you very much. This is a very beautiful point. Thank you for bringing it out. Anybody else would like to share? Especially those devotees who didn't get an opportunity to share. Kiran Mataji, would you like to share something?
Sure, Mataji.
Thank you, Mataji. Mataji, class B. Hare Bol, Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna, Prabhu.
I was reading through the point here, Mataji, about, you know, one was about the independence that you just spoke about. You know, it's very important to use our free will in the right way, and like you mentioned, to choose Krishna, but to choose Krishna, it's like for us, we have to train ourselves to be able to make that choice. So like I practically try to, you know, as to how we do this is basically like when I'm doing any action that I'm doing, you know, whether I'm working, whether I'm cooking, or whether I'm, you know, cleaning, whatever. So trying to keep in mind that, you know, like, it's not like I want to develop that mentality that it's not for myself. I'm trying to, this is a service that we are doing. Like, we, you know, we have DTs at home. So whatever chores we are doing in the house, we're trying to kind of develop that mentality that we try to live our lives around them, you know, like, if I am doing the cleaning in the house, it's basically trying to do as a service to him. You know, if I'm doing cooking, then trying to develop my consciousness that, you know, it's not for our pleasure. It's basically for Krishna's pleasure. So praying to the Lord to kind of give that attitude that I want to do the best service, you know, to make the best food so that I can please Krishna, you know. So even after practicing for these many years, it's still a very, it's not an easy thing to do.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what I'm trying. And I think if we develop that mood,
mm-hmm.
of course, you know, the pride is automatically gone. Like, you know, it's nothing that you're doing for yourself or for like materially. So the more you kind of think about Krishna in your day-to-day activities, practicing that while doing it is the key. And that's how I practically try to, you know, develop that.
Yeah, very, very nice point. Thank you, Mataji, for sharing. Actually, Prabhupada said that if the grihasthas do not worship the deities, they will fall down. So either at the temple or at home, grihasthas, you know, it's very, very good for the grihasthas, you know, to have the connection with the deities, because it's different for, you know, if a brahmachari is living in the temple, or if the sannyasi is traveling, at least he's living with the devotees. But the grihasthas are constantly interacting with worldly minded people. So the best protection is deity worship for them. And the way you described it is so nice. Like, you know, if we can just remember the Lord and dedicate that activity to the Lord as we are carrying on with our daily duties, that's the best protection. Thank you so much, Mataji.
Thank you, Mataji.
Shilpa Mataji, would you like to say something? Hare Krishna. Shilpa Mataji, are you still there? Dushyant Prabhu, would you like to say something? Okay. So, Hare Krishna.
Will you hear my point?
Yes, Dushyant Prabhu, we are able to hear you. Would you like to say something?
Oh, I was just hearing recently that Srila Prabhupada instructed that there's no necessity for, like, extravagant deity worship at home if the temple is within a reasonable distance.
That's correct. Yes.
Everyone should try to
come
to the temple and worship there.
Yes.
Otherwise, you know, I don't know.
You are correct, Prabhu. Yeah, Prabhupada did say that. So, but there is some connect. There has to be some connection with the deities for grihasthas. It's very uplifting for their spiritual life. So we will
like, you know, end here for today. Actually, what is very inspiring is that Krishna, through these verses, is actually telling us that actually we are his part and parcels. Mamai Vansha Jiva Loke means actually all these living entities are my part and parcels. So what it actually means, like how I see it, is that when we say that someone is ours, it means that I care for that somebody. So Krishna actually cares for us, and that's why he's giving us this plan. He's telling us, like, you know, you are just struggling with the mind and senses, but actually that's not you. It's just like the air carrying aromas. You have these different material conceptions of life, and you're transmigrating because of your desires from one branch of this material tree. Like, you know, you're taking on these different bodies, sometimes as a cat, sometimes as a dog, sometimes as a human, sometimes as a demigod. But actually you are mine. So what he wants us is to come back to the spiritual world, which doesn't need any kind of illumination with the sun, the stars, or the moon. It's self-illuminating. So it's actually an invitation from Krishna to all of us to come back to him, because he thinks we are his parts and parcels, and we are actually his parts and parcels. So our natural position is to belong to him. So we'll end here for today, and next week we will complete the chapter. So if you have the opportunity, please read through the purports. We will, of course, be reading them as we study. But if you read them ahead of time, like, you know, then you can come prepared with your questions. And if you have any comments, like, you can come prepared for that. And also, I'll be sending out like a short, small homework. So please try to send it by Sunday. I'll send it to you very soon. So thank you all again for your participation, and we'll meet again next Tuesday. Hare Krishna. Srila Prabhupada ki jai.
Hare Krishna.
Thank you, Mataji.